Welcome, everyone. This is Valerie Wendt, CPA Product Manager here at Gleim. Welcome to today's webinar. It's the first of a series that we're getting ready to kick off entitled Office Hours with Denise Probert. We're pleased to have Denise with us, and I'll give a brief introduction of her in just a moment, but I do want to give you some housekeeping rules with regard to today's event. We are recording today's webinar, and a link will be posted on the Gleim CPA Review website in the next day or two so that you'll be able to access the event again at your leisure. Also, throughout today's event, we are accepting questions. Feel free to submit any questions you have in the chat, and we will try to save some time towards the end to answer those questions. So please don't be afraid to ask questions. Many people learn so much from other people's questions, so we encourage you to do that. Also, throughout today's webinar, we are doing some interactive questions, meaning we're looking for you to engage with us throughout today's event, and you will be answering those questions right on the screen. Some of them will actually be exam-related questions, so you want to pay close attention. So before we get started, I would like to introduce our guest speaker today on this Office Hours series, and Denise Probert. She is a CPA, a CGMA, and she's an instructor at the Lead School of Business at the University of Colorado, where she teaches financial accounting courses full-time. In addition, Denise is a LinkedIn Learning accounting instructor. She consults and coaches as well. And Gleim is pleased to welcome Denise on board as one of Gleim's Gleim Instruct faculty. So we're real pleased to have Denise with us. So Denise, I'm going to turn it over to you so that we can jump right on and cover some very important information.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that introduction, Val. It's always wonderful to work with you and to work with Gleim. Let's go over what I have planned for us today. I thought it might be nice for us to just demystify FAR a little bit and look at it over 4 weeks, because there's four areas on the blueprint published by the AICPA. And I think it's important for us to talk about that blueprint and how it influences the exam and how that content is commonly tested. I do have some interactive questions for you, so we want to keep you engaged, and we're going to start with one of those questions real soon. At the end of this webinar, I will be able to take any of your questions for a period of time, and let's jump in with getting some input from you. I want to know, where are you at? In this exam process, are you just thinking about the exam, or maybe you've applied to your jurisdiction? Just take a look at that question and answer it. Gives me some input on how I can speak to where you're at in this process. I'm so glad that you joined today. It is a beautiful day here in Colorado, and I'm seeing that some of you are here from all over the world, and thank you for letting us know that, where you're at. Answer this question. I think there's just a little bit of time left, and I want to have full participation, so make sure that you tell me where you're at in this process. It's important for us to be fully informed about our licensure process and about the CPA exam. And so this series that we're doing right now is 4 weeks long, and it's designed to help us look at the four areas of FAR. And so this webinar is our first in a series of four. I hope you come back for the rest. It will be next Friday and then the two Fridays after that. And during this particular webinar, I'm going to be showing you how this first area of FAR is likely to appear on your exam. I teach the Advanced Financial Accounting course and the Financial Statement Analysis course at CU Boulder, University of Colorado Boulder. And just this week, we were talking about one of the topics in advanced accounting that I'm going to talk to you about today. So I'm super happy about that. I think that we've got to be close to the survey being done. I'm not seeing any results yet, Valerie. So I don't know if I'm just seeing a wheel that says 70% done.
Yeah, we just closed the poll, and okay. It looks like about 32% of the individuals that responded are just thinking about the exam.
Okay.
There is about 7 individuals who noted that they're going to be taking FAR within the next quarter, and somebody posted in the comments that they're taking their FAR exam in the next 10 days. So this is probably very applicable to them.
Yeah, good luck, Dia. I think this is super exciting time to be taking FAR, and I do see the results now on my screen. Thank you, Valerie, for going over those. So most of you are just starting to think about the CPA exam, and I want to encourage you to keep thinking about the CPA exam. Passing the CPA exam is going to be the probably the most difficult part about becoming a licensed CPA. And once you're a licensed CPA, all the doors open up. Those of you who are scheduled to take FAR in this next quarter, I encourage you to just keep your studies going. And I think that we're ready to jump in, Valerie, when you are.
Okay, we're going to go on and we're going to close this poll. And I think we're ready for it. We got one more quick question to engage with the audience before we move into the content. And so here is the second poll. Janice, if you want to introduce that and tell them, answer right on the screen, by the way, everyone.
Yeah, this second poll is also designed to kind of get your impression about what you may know about this first area of FAR called conceptual framework, standard setting, and financial reporting. So I would expect that you wouldn't know an answer to this. And the actual answer is a little bit more ubiquitous than what any of these answers share with us, because they don't tell us exactly how many questions there's going to be. But they do tell us that this first area is significant to your test. And so I noticed that most of you are choosing either the first or the last two. And the answer is that the first area of the FAR exam covers 25 to 35% of your exam experience. That's right. So if you think about your exam experience being 4 hours long, you could expect to spend a fourth to a third of that answering questions over conceptual framework, standard setting, and financial reporting. So what we're going to do today is demystify what that means, take away all of the ubiquitous nature of that, and just let you know what to expect. Of course, okay. When you're studying with GLIME, they'll have everything there for you. So I'm ready to move on.
Okay, I'm going to end this voting, and you kind of already talked to the results. 23% chose that last option.
Good 16%
job. Chose that first option. So I'm going to close this out, Denise, and then we can go back and we can dive right into the content. Perfect. There you go.
Yeah. So these are the 4 areas of the FAR exam. And you'll notice that first area, which is the focus of today, is conceptual framework, standard setting, financial reporting. What does it mean? What kind of questions can you expect? I'm here to show you. The next 3 areas are ones that you probably studied in your intermediate accounting classes, your advanced financial accounting, or maybe you even have a state and local government class at the school where you took your studies. And those courses also touch on conceptual framework and standard setting and financial reporting, but we don't necessarily do it in such a kind of a way that you might remember it the way you remember studying leases or accounts receivable, for example. The AICPA gives us a set of blueprints, and they update it regularly for changes. And these blueprints break down the content that is eligible for testing in each of the 4 areas. I just put a screenshot of it on this slide. Don't try to read it. You'll break your eyes looking at that small print. But I wanted to show you an example of how that blueprint lists groups and topics, content groups and topics. We're going to look at area 1 only today. And then you might see a blue color and a yellow color and a green color and a gray color. And that's important to understand because that is the cognitive level at which the AICPA has said, let's assess this content at a cognitive level that is higher, like analysis. So this is based on some cognitive hierarchies of learning, mostly Bloom's or Anderson's hierarchy of cognitive levels. And so we're going to take this information and break it down a little bit further for you. So on this next slide, these are the six major content groups within this first area of the FAR exam. We're going to look at each one of these a little bit deeper, but let's run through them real quickly here. We've got conceptual framework, standard setting for both businesses and non-businesses. Then we've got financial statements for for-profit entities. And then we have to take a look at financial statements for non-governmental and not-for-profit business entities. And then we're going to take a deeper dive into what do they mean by public company reporting topics? What is that exactly? You may not even remember that from a class that you took, right? So we're going to take a deeper dive into that. And then this next one kind of is ominous. It's like financial statements for employee benefit plans. What does that mean? What kind of questions am I going to get with that? And then finally, special purpose frameworks. So these are the six major content groups that are within the FAR area one. Remember, FAR has four areas. So this is just the first of the four areas today. Come back next week. We'll talk about area two. So let's take a look at this first content group. It's called conceptual framework and standard setting for businesses and non-business entities. So in this part of the CPA exam, you can expect to receive questions that are going to ask you to recall things like the standard setting process for how a standard becomes a standard, updates. And I'm kind of reminded of a song that I used to sing about how does a bill become a law. Does anybody remember that? It's similar to that, but it's for accounting standards. So conceptual framework and standard setting are both going to be tested on the exam. For conceptual framework, we're looking at, kind of the purpose of conceptual framework and the characteristics of conceptual framework. You'll be glad to know that this portion of this area one is mostly remembering and understanding questions. So you'll be answering theory questions. I actually have an example for us to look at today from the GLIME materials. I would expect most of the questions over conceptual framework and the standard setting process to be multiple choice questions. The second content group is this whole financial statements for profit, for businesses that are for-profit entities. So we're talking about questions over the balance sheet, over the income statement, over the statement of comprehensive income, over changes in equity and statement of cash flows. So any of the questions that are over those financial statements are going to be classified as this area one general purpose financial statements for profit business entities. Now, I would expect most of these questions to be application questions, and you'll also get some analysis questions. What this means is you're likely to get some multiple choice questions over the financial statements, but you're also likely to get some questions in a task-based simulation form. In fact, what I think that you'll be asked to do is, from an application perspective, I think you'll be asked things like to calculate ratios, or to calculate fluctuations in a comparative financial statement. And so I could imagine if you were doing a current ratio, you'd be asked perhaps to analyze then how current ratio changed over the 3-year period. So you're accustomed to performing those sorts of calculations. Make sure that you can also interpret those results. They're looking for a candidate who is not able to just calculate numbers, but is able to do something with them. So make sure you can interpret those results. Also within this category or topic within this area of the CPA exam, you can expect to do things like reclassify OCI. Remember that initially, if we have an unrealized foreign currency translation adjustment that hits OCI, and then we move it to or reclassify it to the net income when appropriate. So it's those types of questions that are really founded in assessing your knowledge of the financial statements. I did jot down some verbs that the AICPA has identified that they'll use in questions, and things like, can you detect, investigate, and correct discrepancies? So if there's a discrepancy, can you see it? Can you investigate it and know what to do with it? I could see this as a task-based simulation, right? Where you're given a set of information, and then you're given more exhibits that you have to poke around in and use to help inform your decision. Another representative task that the AICPA has identified is the ability to adjust when you have to correct an identified error. So if you see an identified error, do you know how to correct that? How do you make the adjustment for that? This is all classified as representative tasks for this second area of second topic of this content group. Mostly multiple choice questions, some task-based simulations possibly. Moving on, we've got this financial statement conversation continuing, but now with non-governmental or not-for-profit business entities. And so you'll be asked questions about the financial statements when they're for a not-for-profit business entity. And remember that the statement of financial position is essentially your balance sheet, your statement of activities is essentially your income statement, and then you've got your statement of cash flows and notes to financial statements. These are mostly going to be application type questions, and the verbs that I wrote down are recall, prepare, and adjust. And whenever you see the word adjust in a question, there you should be looking to possibly see that they've identified an error, a mistake. And so when you see the word recall, that's usually a question that is testing your basic theoretical understanding. And if you're like me, I really like to grab Excel and solve all my problems quickly and kind of ignore that study of the theory and the conceptual. So don't do that, because you will have some conceptual questions in all of these topics, and you'll want to be able to answer those quickly. I do have an example for you today, and it will be an example from this particular area, not this topic of not-for-profits, but this area. So when you're studying for not-for-profit business entities, one of my best pieces of advice is imagine that you're working for a not-for-profit. From the AICPA's perspective, they're assessing your ability to maybe audit, but this is not an audit exam, right? But they're also assessing your ability to prepare the financial statements. So in this particular exam, in FAR, you're going to put the prepare hat on, and you're going to think about these three financial statements as well as the notes to financial statements. I would expect that you would see some multiple choice questions over any of these financial statements and the notes, as well as perhaps a task-based simulation. For sure, multiple choice questions. Now, let's talk about these ominous topics called public company reporting topics. What is this? And these are questions that test your ability to calculate earnings per share or to understand the SEC reporting requirements. There's going to be specific questions that make sure that you understand things like 10Qs and 10Ks and what is an accelerated filer and when do they need to file by. Those are US SEC reporting requirements. And I just listed three or four common topics within this US SEC reporting subtopic. And, you know, knowing what a 10K is, knowing what a 10Q is, knowing the filing requirements of an accelerated filer versus a filing requirements of a non-accelerated filer. Those are examples. I think that your questions in this area will be theory, which means they're testing your ability to remember and understand the conceptual, as well as application questions. So I'm going to give you an example of an application question shortly for both earnings per share and segment reporting. And what I'm going to show you is the common types of questions you'll receive for both of those, whether it's a multiple choice question or a task-based simulation. You will receive questions over any of these topics, and you want to make sure you're ready for that. So the common verbs that I see on the CPA exam around these topics are the ability to recall information. So that's your conceptual understanding of things like when does an accelerated filer need to file? Your ability to prepare. So you might need to prepare a schedule of segments that need to report separately. You might need to identify, again, a lower cognitive level verb at the remembering and understanding level. And so theory questions, heavy on the theory questions here, but you will have some application questions. I'm going to show you a task-based simulation over segment reporting to give you an indication of what it could look like on your exam. Now we have the topic within this area called financial statements of employee benefit plans. Now, we all love our benefits at our employers, right? But pensions seem to be something that are heavily tested on the CPA exam. The accounting for pension plans is one of the topics that is spent, we spend quite a bit of time in our intermediate accounting courses. And the types of questions that you could expect in this area on the CPA exam are around knowing the differences between defined benefit pension plans and defined contribution pension plans. I would expect that you will receive the theory questions, the remembering and understanding, the lower cognitive level questions, as well as some application questions. Let me try to jog your memory. Let me know in the chat how this little memory test goes for you. Do you remember the term plan assets? And do you remember projected benefit obligation? Are those terms that you remember? Just put in yes or no. I want to know if you're still with me here. And do you remember that if the plan assets exceed the projected benefit obligation, then it's funded or overfunded? And if the projected benefit obligations exceed the plan assets, then it's underfunded. And what we have to report is this funding status. Give me another yes or no as to whether you remember that what we have to report on the financial statements is the funding status, right? Whether it's overfunded or underfunded. It's fine if you don't remember these things, because that's what the review process is about, right? That's what the GLIME review process takes you through, and it takes you through wherever you're at. So some of you might have had this just this semester. Maybe you just wrapped it up, so it's fresh in your mind. And some of you may have learned this a year and a half ago, and you're like, covered with cobwebs. So your review program will help you uncover those cobwebs. And I promise you, the second time you study it, it gets easier. I promise you. So what types of questions might you get? Well, I think you're going to get mostly theory and application questions. I don't think you're going to get analysis questions beyond, is it funded, overfunded, or underfunded? I would expect mostly multiple choice questions, but perhaps a task-based simulation. So the representative tasks are really around preparing the statement of changes in your net assets, your plan assets. And you're looking at for both a defined benefit pension plan as well as a defined contribution pension plan. So that statement of changes for the period, you might have to prepare the statement of net assets available for benefits. Those are the two statements that are identified specifically, statement of changes in net assets and statement of net assets available for benefits. This webinar is not designed to teach you those things right now, right here. That's what the GLIME Review course is for. I'm just here to give you some examples of what kinds of questions I think you'll see. And it's better to hear it here than to see it first on the CPA exam, right? So you've got time to pick it up. You'll also need to identify the requirements on financial statements for both defined benefit pension plans and defined contribution. Kosa, you're exactly right. So I did notice that someone said it was not covered in class, and that's one of the coolest things about the GLIME CPA review program is it is a review program, but if you don't have that fundamental knowledge because it perhaps wasn't covered in your university class, you'll get exactly what you need. So again, I'm not here to increase your fretting. I'm here to tell you a bit what's on the exam and then let you know that you can trust the content that you have with GLIME to be able to take you to where you are, from where you are to where you need to be. And multiple choice questions, task-based simulations. Then we've got a topic called special purpose frameworks. We study accrual basis accounting so hard in our financial accounting classes that we almost forget that some entities prepare their financial statements using the cash basis. Accrual basis is not mandatory for everyone. If you have inventory, it is. And there are some businesses that will use a modified cash basis, which is kind of a combination. And then, of course, as we learned in our tax classes, we've got our income tax basis. And oftentimes that is, a result of having a depreciable asset that is depreciating, let's say, under makers. Does makers sound familiar? It's not a FAR term. It's a regulation term. It's a tax term. And the U.S. GAAP could be straight line, right? So you could be using straight line for U.S. GAAP and makers for your income taxes. And they result in a difference then. And so your basis changes will be different. So this whole topic area is really designed to test your understanding of how we can move from one framework to another. So if you were cash basis, how do you move to accrual basis? Or if you're accrual basis, how do you move to income tax basis? So three primary verbs that I see you facing in your questions are, do you recall the theory behind it? And can you perform a calculation to convert from one basis to another? And then the ability to prepare the documentation needed to support your conversion. So special purpose frameworks is a component of your FAR exam. Now, remember, we're looking at 25 to 35% of the exam in this entire webinar. And if I were to try to predict how many questions you would have just over special purpose frameworks out of the initial, did we say, 16 to 23 multiple choice questions, you might get a couple questions, right? So keep this all in context. I recognize that one of you is testing in 10 days, and I don't want to say anything here that would, do anything but support your confidence. So I want you to remember that what we're talking about here today is what you might see in 16 to 23 questions, everything we're talking about today, as well as a couple of task-based simulations. So I want you to leave here feeling more confident. And I also want you to recognize that this area is large relative to the full FAR exam, but all of the topics that we're covering, six content groups, mean that you'll probably get a couple questions, right? So it's something that is, it's not too ominous. I also want you to rely heavily upon your intuition and your gut. You are finely groomed, and you are just one step away from being a certified public accountant. So if you face a question where you're not absolutely sure of the answer, maybe in this area, it's okay. You've got the skills necessary to be able to eliminate some of those answer choices and trust your intuition as you lean towards one of those answers being correct. I believe in you. Absolutely. So let's look at an example RNU question where you're asked to take a look at what a theory question might look like in multiple choice format. And this one is over one of those first areas. I think it was the very first group on standard setting process. Which of the following statements best describes an operating procedure for issuing a new accounting standards update? Maybe the Emerging Issues Task Force must approve a discussion paper before it's disseminated to the public. Or maybe the exposure draft is modified per public opinion before issuing a discussion paper, or maybe a new update is issued only after a majority vote of the members of the FASB, or perhaps the best answer is a new FASB statement can be rescinded by a majority vote of the AICPA membership. Now, what I like about this question and what it makes me feel like it's really kind of a viable question is that it brings in other areas that you've studied. So it's kind of testing your discernment of where does EITF fit into all this? Where does AICPA fit into all of this? Where does the exposure draft and the discussion paper fit into all of this? And so it's a really good example of a great CPA exam question.
Yeah, so just provide your answers right there on the screen. We've only got about half of you answering, so take your best guess.
You're not getting scored on this today.
So a few more seconds and then we'll end this voting, Denise, and then we can share the answer with everybody.
Absolutely.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and end this voting, and then you can take a look at how everybody answered, Denise, before we go out to the answer.
Okay, absolutely. It looks like 41% of you chose the correct answer, and we are going to go out to the answer, as Valerie had mentioned, but I'm just letting you know that 41% of you got it right. That's okay if you didn't, but 10 to 11% got the rest of them. So remember that the Emerging Issues Task Force just is a force of individuals who are, their whole purpose is to tackle new accounting issues. I would imagine they're tackling things like cryptocurrency is what I was trying to think of, Bitcoin, right? These are emerging issues of the last few years that we have to address. So when we're looking at an operating procedure for a new accounting standards update, the Emerging Issues Task Force is not required to approve that at all. So A is not the best answer. The exposure draft is modified per public opinion before issuing a discussion paper. Remember that an exposure draft is issued after a discussion paper, and it's oftentimes published to get public opinion, but it's not modified before issuing a discussion paper. A discussion paper happens first, and then possibly an exposure draft will be included in that process to attain public opinion. So B is, I think probably the one I would not choose, because it includes words that we know are part of this operating process, right? But remember, discussion paper is what is issued. And then we will possibly have an exposure draft as be part of that, as well as public meeting. It does, if we have a new accounting standards update, we do need to have a majority vote by the members of the FASB. There are 7 members of the FASB, so it's easy to get 4 of those. It's easy to get a majority. Odd numbered boards are pretty common. So C is the correct answer. And then the last choice, a new FASB statement can be rescinded by a majority vote of the AICPA membership. Well, I'm a member of the AICPA. I'm never asked to rescind a standard. In fact, the AICPA is a professional or association designed to serve CPAs. And so as an AICPA member, I receive CPE opportunities. They also write, administer, and grade the CPA exam. So the AICPA has many purposes, and they are probably even considered a stakeholder in standard development, the operating procedure, but they have no authority to rescind or to issue a new accounting standards update. So the fact that this said AICPA in it should be a signal to you that it was not a correct answer. When you practice this content well enough, you will be able to look at a question like this, and I would say likely you'll eliminate A and D right away, leaving B and C. So when you're looking at, all 4 choices, you will find that at least 1 and likely 2 of those choices are your least favorites. Don't look at them anymore then. Just focus on the 2 that you have confidence you're looking at. For me, that would have been B and C. And C is an easy one to remember. If you'll remember that that the FASB board does have to vote on every new standard or update to standard, and it is a majority required. There is quite a long operating process for issuing a new standard or an update to standard, and I trust that you will study that process. This is an example of what one question might look like. Remember, you might get 2 or 3 questions over this standard, I would guess at most, and this is a really good example of what one might look like. All right. Let's take a look at another one. Now, we're going to leave this one up on the screen for a bit before you get your answer choices. So go ahead and solve this one, which is a question that gives us information about a company's shares outstanding, stock dividends, stock issuance, and it's wanting to know the weighted average number of shares CEO should use to calculate its basic earnings per share for the year ended December 31st. Grab your calculator, grab your cell phone, go to the calculator, whatever you need to do. You might even be able to answer this without a calculator. And I'm going to give you a couple minutes to solve it.
Yeah. And then when we go to the answer screen, everyone, you'll see the stem and those answer choices, but we're going to leave this up here so you have the numbers to do your calculations. And Denise, you just let me know when you're ready for me to push out the answer options for them. I will do that.
Absolutely. So we're looking for the denominator in the basic earnings per share equation. Your numerator is going to be that net income that's available to common shareholders. So it's this denominator that we are looking for. And this is an example of a question that would be considered an application question. Can you apply your knowledge about earnings per share to some actual data. And they give you the data set in a way that is very similar to what you see in your university classes. Remember that the CPA exam is an academic exam. In fact, it is an exam that is written by professors in many cases. Their question writers are professors. And so this question format should be very familiar to you from your university classes. Oftentimes in a question, you will have information you don't need. In this case, we do need all of the information, but I just bring that up because once in a while you'll have a question that has what I call noise and you have to overlook it. All right, let's put the STEM out. Let's see how they did. Or let's put the poll out. Let's see how they did.
Now you can answer right on the screen. Few more seconds. Appreciate everyone engaging with this.
Yeah, it makes it more fun for everybody, I think.
Definitely helps to get some practice before you have to do it for real.
Yeah. Well, and I think the other really good thing about this is that it shows you that there is not a single question on the CPA exam that is, I think, super hard. Like this question would have been in my university class part of a big hard problem, right? So the CPA exam as a whole is difficult and you need to study hard for it, harder than you've ever studied for any exam. But every exam question is doable. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I am going to, any last minute people want to put their answer in? There's a few people that have chosen not to answer. Make sure you answer right on the screen instead of putting in the chat. And I am going to go ahead and end this voting, Denise, so that we can look at the results.
Sounds good.
Looks like 36% chose option A and 18% chose answer choice C.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go out and I will take you out to the answer and then Denise can explain.
Absolutely.
Why? Let me stop sharing those and I will go back out to the presentation and pull up the answer for everybody. Here you go.
You know, the most commonly missed answer in this case would be A. So those of you who chose A, your brains are on the right place. But remember that stock dividends are assumed to have occurred from the beginning of the year. So that stock dividend 331 date can be ignored. Eliminates A. The correct answer, C, is easily calculated one of two ways. So we have shares outstanding at 1-1, and then we have a stock dividend that can be assumed to have occurred from the beginning of the year. And then we have another stock issuance halfway through the year. Think about these questions this way. Are there any ways that I can take shortcuts because the clock is ticking and I want to keep this simple. The fact that the stock issuance is for half of the year can make you think about this problem in a fairly simple manner. If we know that stock dividends are to be assumed to have been issued from the beginning of the year, we know we had 124,000 shares for the full year. Right? 124,000 for the full year. And then we know that we have that stock issuance for a half a year. So that would be half of 5,000. You don't even need a calculator, right? 124,000 for the full year, another half of 5,000. You can do that in your head. Another 2,500 for the half back half of the year. So the correct answer is the full 100,000 for all 12 months, the full 24,000 for all 12 months, and then 5,000 for half the year, and 126,500. Now, those of you who selected A, you just made one little misstep, and that is that you assumed that the dividend was, because it was issued on 331, that there would be a period of time when those would not be considered outstanding. And, you know, we're expected to include those as if for the full year. And then the second one, nobody chose that B, but that one assumes that the same as A, but it also assumes that that stock issued was issued for the full 12 months. And then some of you chose D. D is the number of shares at the end of the year outstanding. If we add all those numbers up, we get 129,000. Now, I do want to give you an alternative way to solve. This is not the way I solve it, but it isn't a way that you may have solved it. And I want to reinforce prior learning. Some of you may have studied it this way, 125,000 for six of the 12 months and 129,000 for six of the 12 months. Let me know, does that one sound more familiar to you? 124,000 for six 12ths plus 129,000 for six 12ths. Let me know if that triggers any memories for you, because the approach I shared with you is one that it comes from a lot of being a seasoned professor, right? Where I just see that, hey, I've got 124,000 out for the full 12 months, and then half of that 5,000 brings me to 126,500.
Denise, there's a question in there, your comment about being able to answer this question without a calculator. And yeah, they wanted to know if exam questions are generally similar where no calculator was needed to answer the question.
So you will have some questions where you're going to want to grab that calculator quickly because it is not a half a year, or if you can't do quick math in like halves or fourths, then there's nothing wrong with using the calculator. You're probably super fast at it. In your task-based simulations, will have access to Excel that will help you. But I just wanted to show you that, you know, your power of intuition. I see this in my students all the time, every day. They grab their calculator really quick. And if you stage this in your brain the right way, I bet you'll be able to just divide by 5,000 by two and add it to the 124 and get the correct answer. So if your brain is ready to go that fast without a calculator, let it. It will save you some time. But there's nothing wrong with using the calculator on the CPA exam. Okay, so let's take a look at another one. This one is, so that last one was from that topic that was financial reporting. I'm going to have to go back and refamiliarize myself with the this one. Nope, the one before that, Val. I think that I want to go back one more. See the earnings per share, public company reporting topics. So when you see the phrase public company reporting topics and it's not framed up for you quickly as like that's earnings per share and that's segment reporting and that's your 10K, 10Q questions, you're like, what is it? But we just looked at one question over earnings per share and it was really straightforward. Let's go on now and take a look at another one that is right here on segment reporting. Terra Company's total revenues from its three operating segments were as follows. We've got Lion, Monk, and Nevi. You know, I think that at CU Boulder, this is only taught in my class, which is advanced financial accounting. So you maybe heard this for one short, I do it in one day. Which operating segment can be deemed reportable? Remember that in our notes to our financial statements, we're required to disclose operating segments if they meet certain criteria. And there's a qualitative criteria, and then there's quantitative criteria. And those qualitative criteria could show up in a question that is more of a remembering and understanding theory question, like if the management operating style is to consider it to be a separate operating segment, separate business unit, and it meets these quantitative thresholds, then it should be reported in the disclosure notes as an operating segment. This one is testing your understanding of one of the quantitative thresholds. One of the quantitative thresholds.
And for this one, we're leaving this up for a moment so you can do your calculations and figuring out the answer. And then we'll put up the answer ability in just a moment.
Absolutely. Let's go ahead and put it up, Val.
Okay.
I think that we are.
Here you go. So fill in your answer.
Yeah, it's, you know, which of these feels like it is standalone enough to be able to be reported as an operating segment?
But y'all didn't think you were going to have to do exam questions today.
There you go. I mean, you got to have to show them what it might look like. Right?
Yeah. No, it's good experience and good exposure into what they may be asked. So they can, especially the individual that's testing in 10 days, help them to like go back and freshen up on something.
Yeah, some of these. Absolutely.
Good feedback. I'm glad they like it. Somebody said it's really helpful. So good.
That's good. All right, let's be done with this, folks, because I can't wait to share with you. And I just taught this last Monday in my advanced financial accounting class. And I can imagine that this question, before we leave this, let's look. Most people chose C or D, right?
Yep, looks like it.
Perfect.
So let's go back to the answer so that y'all can see what you should have chosen.
Absolutely.
And there you go.
Yeah. So remember that when it comes to your studies of operating segments, you could get questions that are not quantitative. And those questions are really testing that you understand that an operating segment is something that stands alone. Like it has its own, it's business-like. It has its own revenues and expenses. It's not just a cost center. The common clues in the questions are if it says it's just a cost center, it's not an operating segment. Like if it says it's R&D, it's a cost center, it's not an operating segment. A cost center is a common clue that not an operating segment. But you might get a theory question about understanding that this is a kind of a standalone business. It's financial statements are prepared discreetly and management reviews them. So the three things, you're lucky I just covered this, so it's fresh in my mind. The qualitative questions you might get over operating segments are all around, does it have revenues and expenses? Does it function like a business? Does it have its discrete set of financial information, its own set of financial statements? And are those reviewed by management regularly? That's how this question could be framed from a qualitative perspective. From a quantitative perspective, you might remember, give me some feedback on this. I'm going to test your memory again. I want you to be honest. It's okay if you don't remember it. You don't have to remember it now. You're going to study. Percentage of revenue, 10% of revenue, 10% of P&L. That one's a little bit trickier. There's an absolute part of that. And then 10% of assets. So if you remember operating segments, we want them to be big enough in the business that they are... there's something that about that operating segment that an investor or a creditor, a decision maker would want to know. So are its revenues large, defined as 10% relative to all operating segments? Is its profit and loss large relative to absolute value relative to the largest of 10% of combined profits or combined losses? This question does not ask that. Or does it have a lot of assets? Like we've invested a ton of assets into this particular business, so we should disclose it as a separate operating segment. It's 10% rule on all of those. This question is isolated to just revenues. All you need in this question is the last column, but to know that you have to remember that the revenue test includes sales to external customers as well as internal sales. So if we have lion selling to monk, it can be included. If we have Monk selling to Nevi, it can be included in the percentage of revenue test. So we're not going to look at the consolidated after it's been eliminated. We're going to look at the combined. We're looking at combined segments. This is true for the P&L test as well as the asset test. All three of them are looking at the combined operating segment total revenue or total assets. Again, the P&L one takes a little bit more study, but it's not hard. You've got it. So we're looking at the 150 cell, the cell with 150,000, take it times 10%. And then look at Lions. Did it exceed 15,000? 10% of 150,000. Another example of how you may not need to use a calculator, just move that decimal point. Is 100,000 greater than 15,000? Yep. Report Lions separately. You report it as an operating segment. How about Monk? Well, does 26,000 exceed 15,000? Yep. How about 24,000? Yep. Correct answer is D. Let me know if you remember that operating segment lecture from your university. While you're typing that answer in, this is not going to be a poll question. I just want to show you how this question could appear in a task-based simulation. This is the same type of question where we're given across the top, I believe, it's very small on my screen, we have different operating and segment possibilities, and we have to decide whether that particular business unit is going to be disclosed as an operating segment because it passed the asset test, because it passed the revenue test, or because it passed the profit loss test. Or maybe it's not separately reportable as an operating segment at all. I want you to notice on this screen the word exhibits. It's on the left-hand side. It's in blue, all caps, and below it are five links. In this particular problem, unlike the last one, you're going to have to go find all of the revenues. You're going to have to go find all of the assets. You're going to have to go find the P&L. So what I did is pulled it in, and I want you to take a look at this for just a minute while I'm trying to decide if I'm going to sneeze here or not. But you have your income statement as an exhibit, and you have your balance sheet as an exhibit. These are partial. But notice down here, we've got total assets, and they even give you the total. Take it times 10%, 13,400. The other thing I want you to remember, and I'm saying this because I know that when you review this again, it will be the third time you've heard it probably. And that is, it's always the 10% rule. And so 10% would be 13,400 if it's the asset test. To be disclosed in the notes as an operating segment, you only have to pass one of these three thresholds. You don't have to do all three, one. So if they pass the asset test, don't even bother testing them on the others. If they pass the revenue test, don't even bother testing them on the others. So when you're taking the test, what I would do, if I was taking this task-based simulation, I would take this 13,400, and I would say, okay, Potash, they're 79,000. That's bigger than 13,400 operating segment. Phosphate, 13,000, less than 13,400, not an operating segment per this test. Maybe under revenue, maybe under PL. And I would just automatically pick potash, fertilizers, and chemical products. Those three exceed 13,400. And then I would go do the revenue test because that's the next easiest one. You only have to pass one of the tests to be considered an operating segment. So now if we go test phosphate and magnesium on their revenue, we might be able to narrow it down to one and only have to do a P&L on one. So a little tip and technique for how to solve these questions quite simply. Here's a few common mistakes that individuals make. If you misread the question stem and start down a journey that you shouldn't have gone down in the first place, then getting yourself back on the right question stem is a challenge. I encourage people to go to the question stem first. Once you fill your brain with all of the data and the information, fitting the question stem and on top of that is a lot. So go to the question stem first. make sure you understand the requirements of the problem. Some people do make mathematical mistakes. I tend to actually be quite quick in my head with math, but you know what? I'm old enough that I didn't even see a calculator till I went to college. So that's probably why, is that my first 18 years, I didn't even know what a calculator was. You might not know the topic well enough. And let's face it, you're going to go in and you're going to face a question or two where you have to rely upon the fact that you are finely groomed. Trust that. Trust your intuition. Trust your gut. Be careful not to apply the wrong rule or the wrong concept. Don't get too distracted by the wrong answer options. What I'm saying is that today I went through all of the possible answers and I explained them all. But when you're taking the exam, when you find the right answer, choose it and go on. Don't be distracted by other answer choices anymore. Be careful not to eliminate a wrong answer option when it's really the right answer. So I do like the process of eliminating rather than going straight to the right answer if I don't know what the right answer is for sure. So if I'm facing an exam question and I'm not 100% sure, I do the elimination of those that seem least likely. Make sure you trust your intuition. There will be some times when you need to rely upon it. Tackling simulations. This does spend 18 minutes on each task-based simulation. You will have some task-based simulations you'll be able to do in less than 18 minutes and some that you'll need more. This average comes from the AICPA, and we all know that some of those task-based simulations are a bit longer and some of them are quite quick. Make sure you read the directions, scan all of the exhibits, and then don't forget Excel and the calculator are there to help you. Those task-based simulations are designed to test your highest cognitive level. So when you go into that task-based simulation, think to yourself, okay, I'm no longer just remembering stuff. I'm applying it. I'm analyzing it. Memorizing, it tends to not work quite as well in a high stakes exam experience as does fully understanding. But fully understanding requires lots and lots of practice. There's some experts who say that you need to practice something 10 times before you have a full mastery of it. I do self-explanation all the time. I'll explain something to the dog. I'll explain something to the mirror. And that really helps me understand it, because when you have to explain it to somebody else, that's when you prove that you get it. Take lots of practice quizzes. Take your time, but you also have to not let the clock speed up by not working fast enough. Never leave a question unanswered. And get organized. Make sure you have people around you who are supporting you and helping you along the way. Make sure that you clear your calendar. When I was studying for the CPA exam, I studied for 2 hours every day. If I missed 2 hours on a Tuesday, I added it to my Saturday, and then I had 4 hours on Saturday. If I missed my 2 hours on Wednesday as well, then I had 4 hours on Sunday. And so that was my way of handling it. I do think that having some time off is good. It's good for your brain, but I'm a kind of one of those that needs the discipline of a study planner and a schedule that's going to help me know that I am taking the next steps that I need. And by scheduling your exam, you're forcing yourself to have to be ready. And remember that a little progress every day will add up to big results. Questions, Valerie, are there any questions?
Yeah, we have time for just a couple. We are over a little bit, but I don't think people mind.
I apologize.
I really enjoyed the interactivity and the questions you've worked through. So I think everybody's good, but I would like to have you answer a couple that just came in. Yeah. One of them wanted to know, could you please explain the best approach to answer a TBS that has several exhibits?
So I think you should assume every exhibit there is for a reason, but it has more information on it than you need. So my best approach is, I did this yesterday with my students in my class. We were solving for capital asset pricing model. I said, okay, this problem gives you lots of, we were also doing cost of equity. I said, this requires you to have 5 pieces of information, and this problem contains 300 pieces of information. Go find the beta, go find the risk-free rate of return, go find the average return on the market or market risk premium. These are financial statement analysis concepts. Go find your pre-tax borrowing rate and the tax rate. You need those 5 things. So when you take a look at that task-based simulation, you should be asking yourself, what do I need to solve this question? Now, if you don't know that, if you don't know I need these 5 things, then by looking through the information that's there, you can go, oh, that's right, I needed this. Oh, I think I need that too. And pretty soon you'll have the solution.
Yep. And then one other question came in about how to make a better study plan or study planner.
I think that the study planner in your GLIME materials is exactly what you need. But remember, garbage in, garbage out. So if you put in a study date that's not realistic, in fact, I got something recently, a reminder that I'm taking a test this week. But that's, I poorly set up my study planner, right? So set up your study planner to bring you success. Be realistic.
Right.
Yeah,
I always tell individuals whenever I'm providing guidance on the study planner, whether it's the one in the GLIME system or any study planner that you use, it's just to be realistic in what's going on in your life. Because you can over plan to study 4 hours a day when realistically you don't have 4 free hours, whether it's in chunks or at one time. You know, you've got to factor in what's going on in your life.
And make sure you also schedule exercise. Mm-hmm. And our brains need good, healthy food. So I'm going to be a mom for a moment and say, you know, break the habit of eating with processed food and grab an apple.
Yep. Agreed. And then this one last question. Somebody was thinking the employee benefit accounting had been removed from the exam.
It is still on the exam right now. I pulled the information from the most recent blueprints. So there may be conversation about that, but if you were to go take the exam right now,
you probably would see something.
Yeah.
Yep. Absolutely.
Like a question or two. Remember, today's was all about 16 to 23 questions, right? So maybe a couple task-based simulations. So we really took a deep dive today.
Yep. And I encourage you, you're all going to get an automatic invite to next Friday's office hours, where Denise is going to go over Area 2, the select financial statement. So you'll get some more opportunities to work some interactive questions with her. I encourage you to register for that one. If you know of your fellow students or colleagues in your office that might take some interest into this, encourage them, share that invite with them so that they can come along with that. We will be posting this recording on the site. So make sure you check that. I had put the link in earlier for you to go out to our site. I also just want to put a plug in too. I have a webinar coming up on April 26th where I'm going to be talking about the changes that are coming into the exam effective January of 2024. So for those of you that may have an exam that flows over beyond December of 2023, you'll want to pay close attention to some of the things that I share with you about the upcoming exam changes. So I hope you'll stay tuned for that one as well. So I am so thankful, Denise, for all the information you shared. I think the audience really appreciated it. I can't wait for next Friday.
Yeah, next Friday will be Area 2.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone. And we look forward to seeing you next week. Have a great weekend.
Have a great weekend.